jesteśmy w małym angielskim miasteczku, koło mnie jest Tommy Robinson. Trochę znany w Polsce, trochę nieznany. Bardzo mi zależy na tym, żeby dać Tomiemu okazję do tego, żeby powiedzieć, co tak naprawdę myśli w sposób wolny od poprawności politycznej. Oczywiście jestem przekonany, że z poglądami Tomiego można się zgadzać lub nie, ale warto je znać i jestem pewny, że to, co robi Tomi, wynika z jego pojęcia wolności. Bardzo mi miło Cię widzieć. Dziękuję, że znalazłeś czas dla mnie.
Dziękuję. No, it's a pleasure. It's a pleasure to talk.
Dzień dobry.
Dzień dobry. Dzień dobry. Cześć.
Co możesz powiedzieć na temat polskiej historii? Znasz może Dywizjon 303 lub taką postać jak Jan III Sobieski?
I'm aware of Polish history. I'm aware of their fearsome fighting and their history to fight. And I'd say that if I was to sum up even the Polish community that have come to our country, if I was to sum the Polish community up in, say, five words, it would be strong. I'd say religious as well. That is what we see. Hardworking, loyal, and just, yeah, a credit to your country. Where I sense we're going now in Europe, I think again, the Polish people will be needed and their history of fighting against these problems will be needed. And I think that whereas a lot of people around the world always look to us, to Britain and at different times, I think now that Western Europe will be looking to Eastern Europe for help in the problems we're going to face. So I understand that the Polish don't feel that, or that through history, that their commitment and the sacrifice that they gave would have been recognised properly. It should have been, and we recognise. And when we talk about division, I even know when the Polish community would have come into England, there would have been teething problems for a couple of years. Now, if you speak to any average English person, they're grateful. Grateful to the Polish community who've come. Grateful for the hard-working, decent people. From the English point of view, we're grateful for the sacrifice that the Polish gave in the Battle of Britain, and I think they had more kills per head than anyone else in that battle, and we probably wouldn't have this be free as we were today if it wasn't for the sacrifice of the Polish people. And looking up the Polish king with the gates of Vienna, the Battle of the Gates of Vienna, I've read up myself, and he seems like he was a warrior. I know the Polish was seen as the saviour of Christendom. The Polish king was seen as the saviour of Christendom. He saved Christendom from the onslaught and the attack and the takeover from the Islamic armies. And I think that Polish people are going to have to come as a saviour once again with the struggle we're heading towards.
Przyglądając się Twojej działalności, bardzo łatwo jest się pogubić. Zakładałeś English Defence League, wycofałeś się potem z tego, współpracowałeś z liberalnymi muzułmanami, z Majidem Nawazem, potem z Pegidą. Ostatnio można było przeczytać w polskiej prasie na temat Twojej głośnej dyskusji z księgarzem w Birmingham. Kim dzisiaj jest Tommy Robinson?
My whole life has been a learning experience. From where I'm brought up, from where I've grown up in Luton, for those in Poland who don't know about Luton, it was a launch pad for the fertilizer bomber, the Stockholm bomber. It's had the most terrorists per head than anywhere else in Europe. We have 40% Muslims. We have 30 mosques, just 30 mosques in my hometown. So my whole life I've experienced the problems that Islam will bring. Because of that, I established the English Defence League. I've always been searching for an answer. Everyone, we need an answer. And if people back home don't realise how embedded this problem is in our country, how huge this problem is, there's zero integration, zero assimilation. We have people in our country who wish to cause us harm and war and subjugate us as non-Muslims. We have 100 Sharia courts. So I've learned. I set up the English Defence League. I then left the English Defence League trying to find a more politicised way to deal with this problem and speak about this problem. You're right, I did cooperate with what I would have been seen as liberal Muslims. But what I found out was that they were just not Muslims. They were apostates, but they're not free to say they're apostates. So again, when they're talking about the issues, they're talking about them from a non-Muslim point of view. I don't see in my learning curve that there's any chance of reformation for Islam. Recently, my recent activities, when you talk about Britain First, I was reporting. So currently what I'm doing now is reporting for an organisation called Rebel Media, which is I see as a good outlet to raise these issues and highlight these issues. The media in the UK, I don't know how it is in Poland, but the media in the UK have all slandered, lied and attacked anyone who speaks out against the status quo of the liberal elite or the government. Anyone who criticises Islam is put into a box and slandered as a racist, as an extremist, as a Nazi, all things that we're not. We're just simply criticizing a fascist and violent ideology. So that's who I am today. I am the same person. I'm an English man who wants my country to be free. I want a safe and prosperous future for my children. And the future, sitting here now, knowing where our country's at, is terrifying. It's terrifying. And that's what really people in Poland and other countries need to really realise, just how quick this grows. That's the other thing, is how quick Islam will spread and how the left will align themselves with it. That's what's happened in our country, which is insane to say. The people who are supposed to defend minorities, as in whether it be homosexuals, whether it be freedom of speech, whether all their core points of view that are on the left, they just give them away for Islam, and they defend an ideology which goes completely against those beliefs.
Jaki jest twój stosunek do nacjonalistów, prawicowych ekstremistów i antysemitów?
I see right-wing extremists and the anti-Semites as a big problem, because they deter our message. And because, yeah, I throughout my last 8 or 9 years, I've had a straight message that I do not stand with them, I do not tolerate them. There's a minority of them, but they damage our message. They damage the true people's message. So yeah, what do I think of them? I think I view them as opposite sides of the same coin of Islam. Islam and far-right extremism.
Yeah. Jakich wartości bronisz?
In one word, freedom. Freedom, whether it be, I stand for the freedom. Freedom against Islam. What do I stand for? What do I stand against? I'm opposed to the fascism. I'm opposed to basically the attack that Islam's having on our society. I believe in complete free speech. And freedom of religion.
Jakimi metodami chcesz walczyć o to, w co wierzysz? Jakimi metodami chcesz działać, żeby to osiągnąć?
I think eventually we'll have to apply a lot more effort in defending them. But currently, I see my role as waking people up, as talking about this issue, highlighting the issue, and just raising awareness. That's what I see my position as. My position is raising awareness and educating people from my background who don't understand much about Islam, who don't know about Islam, who are naive to Islam. I see it as my job to enlighten them and highlight them and wake them up and educate them on the real threat that we face moving forward.
Chciałbym Cię dopytać o kwestię kłopotów z prawem. Parę razy przyznałeś się do tego, że stałeś przed sądem i przyznałeś się do postawionych Ci zarzutów. O jakie sprawy chodziło?
Since I first started my activism, the law has been used against me. I had the full weight of the state come down on my shoulders. They have used everything and anything they can to silence and stop what I've been doing. So you would have seen sometimes when I have been in court and I've been imprisoned, and I don't mean to, I'm not going to sit here and lie to you. Luton, the town I'm from, has been rated the roughest town in Britain. It's got the highest poverty levels in Britain. It's a town with huge problems. So I've never been an angel growing up. But the things I've been imprisoned for since my activism with the English Defence League, I haven't done. And I believe it's been done on purpose to get me in a position. In the UK, prisons are like ISIS training camps. That's what they are. Muslims have complete control. So I believe that to get me in prison the first time was a chance to break me, mentally break me. I spent 22 weeks on solitary confinement. That time I was in prison because I illegally entered America. I went to America because I felt that I have a warning to give. As now, I'm sitting here talking to you because I feel that as an Englishman and I've experienced what's happened here, I have a warning to give to Poland. And you have to hear it. Because the future of your children's future will depend on understanding and tackling and preventing Islam from having influence in your society.
Z drugiej strony nazywasz siebie więźniem politycznym. Zdarzyło ci się nawet w więzieniu przeprowadzić strajk głodowy. Dlaczego? Co się takiego stało w więzieniu, w areszcie, że zdecydowałeś się tak desperacki krok?
The offence that I was in prison for, what they said in the end, was mortgage fraud, which I pleaded guilty to. But I only pleaded guilty to that because they had my wife and my other family relatives on charges, and it was used as a blackmail against me. If you don't want your family to go through the stress and pressure of court cases, then plead guilty. So the reasons I was in prison was for my political belief. that now what they got to put it on paper, because I did plead guilty, but I had to plead guilty. If I didn't plead guilty, you have to understand that I've had 6 Osman warnings. An Osman warning in the UK is a government intelligence warning to say people are going to kill you. There's been 6 Muslims put in prison for 30 years because they got caught with guns and bombs on the way to kill me. Now, I have to, when I walk the streets, I live in danger. I'm regularly violently attacked and there's regularly plans to kill me. My wife, no one knows what my wife looks like. Yeah? So if my wife walks down the street of Luton, she doesn't get a hard time because no one knows who she is. That's been very difficult for me to maintain that. So what they then did was they got me in a position where they had my wife and they said, she is going to court in 2 weeks. All the journalists are going to take pictures of her. Everyone's going to know what she looks like. For me as a husband and as a father, it's my duty to protect them in any way I can. So that was when I was offered a deal. Go guilty, where I'm going to prison. Go guilty and we leave your wife. And I've got all this in paperwork. I've got all of these, the evidence of this case. So that's when I said I was a political prisoner, because I feel that I was put in prison because of my political beliefs, because of what I was saying, and they wanted to silence me.
Pisałeś też i nagłaśniałeś taką sprawę. Mówiłeś o tym, że w więzieniu cię pobito. Jak do tego doszło i jak na tą sytuację zareagowały władze więzienia, władze tego aresztu, w którym byłeś?
So, when I was in prison, as soon as I got to prison, my door opened and a prison officer, who was an ex-Royal Marine, British military, he said to me, when they come to get you, do not leave this cell. I said, what? He said, when they come to get you, do not leave this cell. Your life depends on it. Yeah? So then 20 minutes later, he's opened my door with 2 more prison officers. And he said, come on, you're going to B-Wing. And I said, I'm not going anywhere. And he's told me not to before that. He's then arrested me. And then I because of my arrest, I stayed locked in my cell. He come back hours later and said, where they were taking you was where the 6 Muslims are in the same prison. The 6 Muslims are who are serving 30 years, who are in jail for planning to kill you. They were handing you to them. Yeah. Now, the offence I was in for was because someone filled a form out wrong on a mortgage application. Yeah. They took me to the maximum security prison in the UK where all the terrorists are. So in my view, that can be of no mistake. The next day, after this was prevented, the next day I went to see my solicitor. Afterwards, I was walking back, they opened a door, the prison officer, and they locked me in a room with 3 big bearded Muslims, and I was violently beaten and I was fighting for my life. In that attack, I lost my teeth. The only good benefit is I got some new teeth, but I lost my teeth and I was violently beaten. Now, this didn't just happen in one jail. When I was moved from this prison, there was an attack with boiling water and sugar to throw in my face. I prevented that through fighting. At 3 different prisons, they put me in a position where Muslims had an opportunity to kill me. Now, that goes against all the legalities and guidelines of the British prison system, which has a duty of care to keep you safe. So I feel that 100% intentionally that was done. But I managed to get through the prison sentence. I managed to fight my way through it, and I'm still here today. But I don't think that's for any... Their intention was for me not to come out of prison.
Jak uważasz, kto jest twoim największym wrogiem? Brytyjska poprawność polityczna, policja, czy może konserwatywni polityczni muzułmanie?
If you want to know how powerful it is, political correctness, and this I think will be a shock to people in Poland. When the report was done in one small town in the north of England, there was 1,400 young girls who were beaten, raped, pimped and abused every day. Yeah? And the police knew full well what was going on. They complained to the police, but the police didn't make any arrests. The reason they didn't make any arrests was because they were scared of being called racist. So for people in Poland to really understand just how powerful it is, it paralyzed, fear is paralyzing, and that fear paralyzed our leadership, our politicians, our police forces, our social workers, to allow Muslim men, gangs, to rape young English girls, and no one done anything. So that's just, and I think for people in Poland, when you hear these stories, you think, what? The police didn't make arrests. They knew it was going on, they let it happen because the men were Muslim and the victims were young, white English girls. That is how powerful it is. As soon as you try to talk about these issues, you're tarnished, you're targeted, you're threatened with violence, you lose your job, you lose your career, everything comes on top of you. And when I speak to people in East Germany, they said it was the same with communism. They said you couldn't talk about it, you lose your job, this. So that's what we've experienced with Islam. Now, from where we were 9 years ago when we first started to where we are now, there's a lot more people talking, thankfully. It was quite a lonely place at the start. When we was the English Defence League, it was just us. And we were viewed upon, and you have to understand that there's been a huge shift in this country where what I would have been saying years ago, 8, 9 years ago, people viewed me as an extremist. Now, people realise I was correct. People are realising it was the truth. People are realising that all the things we were warning about, the gangs raping young girls, all the problems that we're... And the only reason why we've seen them is because I've grown up amongst it. Now, people are realising, wow, they were right. They were right. So, political correctness, the police, not the average police officer on the street, because they seem very sympathetic, but our police in Britain are being used politically. So the hierarchy of the police force are like politicians, and they're being used in order to be, they're being used as a weapon, silence, disrupt and stop what many of us are doing.
Jak wygląda twoje codzienne życie? Jaką cenę płacisz za to, czym się zajmujesz?
In the early days, I started wearing a bulletproof vest. I had many violent beatings, and it was very hard to deal with and accept, which took me, it was a big struggle for me, because I went from working on a building site to within 12 months being the most critical voice of Islam at that time, I'd say, in Europe, on the streets. And along with that came the real threat of death. And I couldn't deal with that. It was hard for me to deal with that, and I struggled to deal with that. I felt like I was walking around with a terminal illness. And I struggled. And now, where I'm at now is, I fully accept that. And I expect it, and I don't say that. I say that because I've had deep thought about this. I live every day like it could be my last day, because at the minute I'm fully aware that at some point a Muslim will kill me, because I've accepted that. I know that. I know that because I look at the plans they've done. Multiple times they've been put in prison for planning it. The violent beatings I've had, I've escaped it luckily a couple of times. But at the same time, I made a decision where if I run once, I'll run for the rest of my life. So, and if I do get killed, I'd rather get killed with my head held up.
Masz teraz na sobie kamizelkę kuloodporną, czy nie?
I stopped. So at first I did put a bulletproof vest on, and that's when I decided that I walk. So Luton, my hometown, I walk through. When we finish this, I'm going straight to Luton. I'm not gonna hide from it. I'll do what I want, I'll live my life the way I want, and if I do get killed, then my blood will be on the British authorities' hands, it will be on the police's hands, because the police have failed multiple times to arrest or prosecute people who have violently beaten me or threatened me.
Co powiesz tym, którzy w internecie otwarcie życzą ci śmierci?
So in the UK, we've had through fake news, the best thing to come out of Donald Trump's election is the term fake news, because I've had fake news non-stop for 8 years. The media will tell people, I stand for this, I'm a racist, we're Nazis, which is just completely false. So some people who dislike me or hate me, when I talk to them, when I have discussions, I'll give you an example. I was out in Hitchin, which is near here, and I was violently beaten by 6 men. Yeah? The next day I found out who they were, and I went to their houses. And the first man's house I knocked at, and when, after having a discussion with him, what I found was that the things he hated me for was nothing to do with what I've ever said or stand for. So he's been lied to. So I'd say that he's a victim as well as me, yeah? Because he generally, and if I read the headlines that are reported about me, if I was in my hometown and I read that this man was coming to my town, I might be angry. I might think, I don't want him in my town. I don't want this Nazi in my town. But the truth is, that's all lies. So these people have been lied to as well. Lied to on a huge level by our media. So to the people who wish to openly or threaten me with death, if I was to die now, I'm quite comfortable in the fact that a lot of people judge me now, but I'm comfortable in the fact that history will judge me. And I will be proven right time and time again in this struggle, in the facts about what's going to happen. Many of the predictions we made 8 years ago are all now coming in. Many politicians and radio presenters and journalists are now saying what we were saying years ago. To the people who wish me death, yeah. I'm not going anywhere, so you'll have to kill us.
Wielu ludzi w Wielkiej Brytanii mówi, terroryzm nie ma kompletnie nic wspólnego z islamem. Jak możesz odpowiedzieć na taką opinię? Czy z tą opinią można się zgodzić, czy nie?
With that opinion, so the Prophet Muhammad, if he was here now, he's a terrorist. He killed, he raped, he massacred. This is not my opinion. This is from Islamic scripture. Islamic scripture says all of this. Yeah? So when you have him as the perfect man, and Muslims must emulate him, that's where the problem lies. The problem lies in the actions and deeds of Muhammad, the sort of man he was. He was a morally bankrupt man. But yet, for some reason, we're not allowed to say this, which we should be. We should be looking at the life and the deeds and the things he did, and they should be completely open for criticism. And we shouldn't be telling 3 or 4 million Muslims in the UK that it's okay to emulate this man. It's that this man was perfect, because he was far, far from perfect. So, when they talk about separating the two, they're embedded, they're enshrined. The actions, the Quran has over 100 verses inciting non-Muslims to terror, to violence and war and terror. That's it. And my what I always say to people is just pick up the Quran, pick up and read the life of Muhammad to understand what we're up against. Because at the same time, what we currently have is our national curriculum and the media and everyone. Do you know the phrase Islam, the religion of peace? Before September 11th, you can go through and look for this phase yourself. Yeah? It's not there, okay? Since September 11th, which I'd call the great lie, since September 11th, which started with George Bush, when he stood up and said, this is a betrayal of Islam. Islam is a peaceful religion. Yeah? It's not. Muslim experts will tell you that. It's a religion of war. Muhammad was a warrior. For us, we're up against a campaign where for example, my children now, again, I'll bring you back to an example. My daughter, I had the biography of Muhammad where I was preparing for a debate. And my daughter walked past and she's 7 years old. And I don't talk to my children about Islam, religion. I've hid all of this from my children. Even when I've been in jail, they think I was working away. I've never spoke to them because they're children. Let them be children. Yeah? My daughter walked past and said, Muhammad, peace be upon him. And I said, what did you just say? And she said, Muhammad, you have to say peace be upon him. I said, well, who has told you that? She said, school. I said, your school told you to say peace be upon him? She said, yes. And this is another example. We went to look at my daughter's next school when she was 9. And on the tables, you had the religious symbols with the church, with the houses of prayer. And the children's task was to put which religion is which with the different symbols, and they're 9. I watched the only one, they could do Christianity, but the only other one the children could do was Islam. Yeah. So every single child as part of the national curriculum in the UK has to visit a mosque. Every child. So my daughter didn't, she was ill that day at school, yeah? But every child is being taken to a mosque. Now in the education system, they are teaching, because I can give you the books, they are teaching that jihad means inner struggle. Now it doesn't. It doesn't. First and foremost, jihad is holy war. First and foremost, you can get that from any one of the scriptures or the authentic books on Islam. But that's what they are teaching. They are teaching that, and for too long in this country, I went on a debate with a Muslim imam, and we was at Swansea University. Now he sat down and said to the students, the word Islam translated, it means peace. Yeah? Now I sat there and said, no, it doesn't. It does not. And he went, I said, it means submit, translated. Yeah? And he said, yes, Tommy, yes. I said, well, what do you mean, yes? I said, am I right? He said, yes. I said, so why did you just say Islam means peace when it means surrender, which is complete opposite to peace? But the problem you've got is in the UK, for 20 to 30 years, Muslims have sat on TV and in debates and they've said this. They've lied and lied and lied, and people are too scared. In universities, they're lying, and no one's picking them up. Students are scared to pick them up because of this cloud of political correctness. People are scared to correct them. People are scared to challenge them. You've got people, our university system, this is the biggest worry that you should have in Eastern Europe as well, is that every single institution in Britain, from schools, universities, prison systems, everything is being used by radical Islamist ideology. Everything is being used to indoctrinate and radicalize a generation. Everything. There's nothing that's not being used. And that is insane to think. The university system in our country, people used to be worried about their children going to university and getting hooked on alcohol or drugs. Now they're worried that their child will come out a terrorist.
A jak duży jest to problem, jeżeli chodzi o kwestie terroryzmu i ekstremizmu w Wielkiej Brytanii?
I don't think terrorism is our biggest threat, and I'll explain why. Terrorism, so 4 times as many Muslims have gone to fight for ISIS from Britain than have joined the British military, ever. 3,500 Muslims are on 24-hour day, 7-day-a-watch from our security services because they know they are ready to strike against us. 3,500. The terrorism arrest rate goes up 60% on average every year. We've had, I think, 325 arrested last year on terrorism charges. So when we're going through how big is the problem, the problem is huge. For me, terrorism is one aspect. The bigger threat that we need to be looking at is the infiltration of our government institutions by people with the same goal, the same mindset. If you look at the beliefs of the Muslim community in Britain, 26% of British Muslims said they want Sharia law, 26%, and they believe we should have Sharia law. That's roughly 750,000 Muslims. Then they say a small figure, 6% of Muslims believe suicide bombing is okay. 6% of Muslims is 200,000 people in our country. 66% of British Muslims would not tell the authorities if their friend was becoming a terrorist for ISIS. 66% would not do the right thing. 66%. So if you look at the mindsets of the people coming into our country. So if you look at Egypt, for example, 90% of Muslims in Egypt believe that stoning for adultery is the right and the best punishment. Stoning a woman. These are the people that are coming in. 90% of people from Afghanistan and Pakistan and Pakistan believe that people who leave Islam should be punished by death. Okay, it is right for us to question whether these people coming into Europe, coming into Poland, whether they're going to assimilate, integrate, whether they're going to benefit your country and our country. And the reality is no. The reality is they're going to bring huge, huge problems with them. And then our people, our community are going to be left under a violent onslaught, which is what we've experienced in the UK. We've experienced, if you look at the rape statistics, and again, these are facts, the rape statistics for street gang grooming, which is where large groups of men, many of these men are brothers, cousins, sometimes father and son, are raping young girls together. Now, this is something that our country's never experienced. 90% of these men who have been convicted are Muslim. 90% from a population of just 4% of the country. So you understand how big this problem is. 20% of these men are called Muhammad. When you go through the court statistics, 20 court arrests, 20% are called Muhammad. The problem is immense, and people are really underestimating how big the problem is. And you have to understand, only 4% of our country, or 5%, is Muslim. Now, where's the most problems in Europe for terrorism? Well, it's in France. That's because France has more Muslims. This is simply a demographic issue. Now, what Poland should be doing, what you have to be able to do, is understand the real threat it's going to pose and prevent it. And prevention should be the best answer.
Okej, okay, zgadzamy się na to, że istnieje problem, natomiast teraz trzeba zapytać o rozwiązania. Jakie rozwiązania widzisz w tej kwestii? Co możemy zrobić?
Many of the mosques, Amadrat, I've just seen in Sweden, they've opened a mega mosque in Sweden, funded by Qatar, the same funders of Hamas. Saudi Arabia fund many of the madrasas across this country. Many of the Islamic schools, which are bringing the children up, indoctrinating them with Wahhabism, Salafism, real, even Diabandi sect, real extreme conservative sects of Islam. Yeah? Not the real, if you have got a bit of Sufism or you have got a bit of Ahmadiyya, different, more liberal and relaxed sects, they're not the ones that are being pushed. It's the really extreme sects. So we should be preventing any money coming in from those countries. I believe we need to prevent Islamic immigration coming in. It has to be stopped. And if you look, if you just stop the refugee crisis, even just stop refugees, there'd be an extra 214 people alive just from last year in France. Yeah? This is real. And this is a real threat to our security, our stability, our country. Now, the growing demographic, I'll bring you back to my hometown again of Luton. By 2030, which is only now 13 years, The Pakistani and Bangladeshi community will increase by 70 to 77%. The white and black community will increase by 1.3. The reason for this, yeah, so this is no mistake. On average, Muslims in the UK have 5.6 children. On average in France, I think it's 7.1. Yeah? So we are having 1.3 children on average. So Labour parties and far left and left-wing organisations and political parties, they know where the future is. So in Luton, there's no future with us as English. The future lies with the Muslim community. So everything politically is aimed at the Muslim community because they know that's where they will gain power and keep power. Yeah? So, but we could address that issue by simply stopping benefits for more than two children, which would make sense. Whether you're white, black, brown, Asian, Muslim, why are you getting paid to have seven or eight, nine children? My local imam has three wives and 14 children. Okay. How do you compete with that? If we skip one generation of men doing that, yeah, that is how quick, we get laughed at, and people say, only 4% are Muslim, and they laugh, like, what are they going to do? Every 10 years since 1960 or 70, the Muslim population of this country has doubled from 360,000 to 600,000, 600,000 to 1.2 million, 1.2 million to 2.4 million. What's next? So don't be the apathy of thinking there's not many, it's not that big of a problem. It's a huge problem. And it can happen like that. I look at areas of Luton where 5 years ago there wasn't a problem. And now it's like, how has this happened? So that's what really is a warning to people in Poland. And you'll have the liberalist who will be defending and saying, we must help them, we must help them. You're not going to help anyone by destroying your own communities. I think we should be helping the people who are in need in the Middle East, but not by bringing them to our countries. We should be helping them in their own. We should be helping them and preventing and making sure there's safe zones for them. But not this current invasion that we're seeing. It's not a refugee crisis, it's an invasion of Europe by military aid Muslim men. And I'm not for, when people take up my views, it's look, I'm all for helping women. I personally think we should be opening our British embassy in Saudi Arabia and letting every woman leave. That's what I'd like to see. But and leave the men standing there scratching their head while there's not a woman left in their country. Because the enslavement of women under Islam, all of these issues, but you're not allowed to talk about them. That's the problem.
I na koniec ważne pytanie. Czy mamy szansę wygrać, ochronić naszą wolność?
So I think that, you know what, you get people now saying to me, it's too late, it's too late, it's too late, we can't win, we can't win. 4%, what do you mean we can't win? Like, if everyone had the attitude we've got now, even if the Polish would, from Squadron 303, if they'd have had the attitude we've got now, yeah, we wouldn't have gone and fought. We wouldn't have won the war. But I had my wife's nan say it to me, say, it's too late. I said, if everyone had that attitude, we'd all be speaking German. I said, but they didn't have that attitude. They didn't. 14-year-old children were pretending they were 16 so they could go run and fight and battle. Now, grown men are hiding behind their curtains, scared to talk about Islam. That's what's happened. That's where we're at. We have bred a generation of cowards. Our generation is a complete generation and a shame on our forefathers of what we've let become and how we've done it. And that's, but do I think we will prevail? I believe that fighting spirit will be reignited. I don't, no one can say what it's going to be, when it's going to happen. A defining moment will happen in our country's history. Similar to the situation in Northern Ireland, Bloody Sunday changed the whole direction of that country and the war. I think something big will happen here that will make people rise up. Unfortunately, it wasn't the rape of 1,400 children because people still ignored it. It wasn't the beheading of a British military personnel on the streets of our capital. Who knows what it's going to be? I look at when the London riots were going on and I was of the opinion people won't rise up. When the London riots were going on, there was a night where I went to Tottenham, I went to Enfield, and thousands of English men come out. And I remember standing there looking, thinking, wow, they come out to chase and stop the violence from these hoodlums who were attacking shops and burning the city. And the English men then come out to confront them. Now, I keep thinking, and I remember, and that reinstored faith in me that day that when this happens, when, because it is going to happen, there's going to be a moment in Europe, and I think it will all come to a head personally in 4 years' time at the next elections when Wilders wins, when Le Pen wins, because I don't think it's going to happen this year, when the Swedish Democrats win, when in 4 years' time there's another election, you have to look at what's happened in the last 12 months in Europe and then dream about or have a nightmare about what's going to happen in the next 4 years. because in 4 years' time, we're all going to have shifted completely further. The left will be booted out of power in every Western European country because they have facilitated, accommodated the destruction of our nations.
Mamy też tutaj książkę Tomiego Robinsona, Wróg państwa, książka ważna, która teraz jest tłumaczona na język polski, więc polski czytelnik będzie miał okazję zapoznać się z jej treścią. Myślę, że warto to zrobić. Myślę, że warto znać głos Tomiego Robinsona. Przy okazji moja przyjaciółka prosiła o podpis, o autograf, gdybyś zechciał.